A big welcome to all of you back in the room and to our online audience. My name is Ruja Navi. I'm a visiting fellow at the German Marshall Fund, and it's my great pleasure to be here, not only cooperating on the project, but also back at CU, which is my alma mater, so it's an additional honor for me to be here and chair such a distinguished panel today. We have four fantastic speakers today with us, with whom we are going to continue to explore challenges to liberal democracy. We have already received quite some food for thought from Professor Ignatiev, and we are going to try to dig deeper in certain aspects of what kind of threats are posed to liberal democracy, predominantly in Europe, in the European Union, but we will also have a contrasting perspective from our colleague Thomas Carothers, who will talk about the US. So we have with us Stefan Lindberg, who is a professor and director of the Wiedem Institute at the University of Gothenburg. We will then continue with Marlene Wind, who is a professor at the University of Copenhagen. Mika Ferlo is joining us as well, professor of comparative politics and inequality at the Radboud University. And finally, we will have Thomas Carothers, who is senior fellow and co-director of the Democracy, Conflict and Governance Program of the Carnegie Endowment. Without further ado, I would pass the floor now to Stefan, who is going to share with us some of their findings about the third wave of autocratization that we are facing in the world today. Stefan, please, the floor.
Thank you. Yes. Third wave of autocratization. So this Authlib project is about Europe. I'll put that in global context. And I'm going to base it on the democracy report that we put out in an article in democratization this year. This is a basic first message. The level of democracy enjoyed by the average global citizen today is back to 1989, or even before. That should put things in perspective, I think. How does the evidence look like? It looks like this. So here is a graph showing the world average liberal democracy index in the world, different regions. You see this backsliding. And if we draw a line back here in time, we end up here. That's the first point. Yes, but it's also that real dictatorships are starting to come back. This doesn't work with me. Okay. Right. So Andreas is here. We recognize this kind of stuff. If we take the same underlying data in the liberal democracy index, but we use it to classify regimes into either closed autocracies, electoral autocracies, electoral democracies, and liberal democracies, then the evidence looks like this. So the dark red line here from 1971, so the last 50 years, and they were in steep decline. They were almost getting extinct, right? We had to put them on the red list. and then have started to come up again, and increasingly so. Meanwhile, liberal democracies are going down. Electoral autocracies, a la Hungary, is the most common regime type in the world. If you put these two together, electoral autocracies, close dictatorship, 70% of the world population now live in those. We know this is going to lead to more wars. This Russia invasion of Ukraine is, from IR scholars, conflict scholars, not such a big surprise. Democracies don't fight wars with each other. Democracies have a lot less other types of armed conflicts as well. Here's the probability curve for armed conflict along the axis of vertical accountability, if you like, or electoral constraints. And here's Russia from 1996 to 2021 on that probability curve. If Russia had stayed as a little bit democratic they were in 96 before Putin took power, the probability of Russia engaging in an armed conflict would have been very low. Second, if we look at the countries that are right now changing, we see a record, actually from 1900, 33 countries at the same time autocratizing. How does the evidence look like for that? Like this. So last 50 years, but it would be. So again, here is number of countries democratizing, the blue purple line. At the height of the wave here in the mid-1990s, 72 countries democratizing at the same time, moving upwards. Not all becoming democracies, obviously. That has just dropped down to 15 by our last count. And meanwhile, starting with Russia and Chavez in Venezuela, a number of countries are autocratizing, and that's in steep incline. This really serious also because we looked at all episodes of autocratization that started in democracy since 1900 and onwards. Almost 80% of them died. So just extrapolating from that, the statistical probability of countries today and then episode of autocratization that they will survive as democracies is very low. Which ones are the worst? Here's the top 10 in the last 10 years. The countries that have autocratized the most and sort of broad Hungary, Poland, Hungary, everybody knows about that. Serbia, of course, as well, among them. This 80% also plays out, right? They were all one or the other type of democracy 10 years ago. 7 out of 10 are now one or the other form of dictatorship. If we take a short-term perspective, last 3 years, it looks like this. These are the worst in the last 3 years. Poland still there, then also Slovenia in Europe. This clicker. Okay, let's take a closer look at this in the EU then. Now six, I submit, six out of the EU countries are autocratizing. Here they are, Hungary, Poland, Slovenia, quite radical, as you saw in the last 3 years, to a much lesser degree, but still statistically significant, Croatia, Czech Republic, and Greece. And then you have the eastern flank neighbors that are not making things better. So it is kind of a dire picture of Europe becoming part of this global wave of autocratization. We see now that this wave of autocratization is maybe, I don't know, changing nature, question mark. For one thing, the polarization that was discussed earlier today as well is spreading all across the world. It's not only the United States and some other countries. We see toxic levels now in 40 countries. The evidence looks like this. Here, all countries in the world, if you're above the line, compared in the last 10 years, since 2011 to 2021, if you're above the line, things have gotten worse, more polarization. If you're in the upper third, it's toxic. The kind of one you have in the United States where the political opponents are the enemies of the nation, or enemies of our way of life, enemies of who we are. What do you do with enemies?
Destroy them.
Yeah. It's a slippery slope that makes us think about the 1930s, right? And it's all regions in the world have these. And it's very closely associated with autocratization, right? So here is just 5 of the top 10 as illustrative examples. You see 3 indicators for each country in blue, different kinds of blue of polarization. And then the red line is the liberal democracy index. Polarization goes up and then levels of democracy go down. They are using it as a strategy for undermining civil liberties and freedom of civil society and so on and so forth. And now, of course, already mentioned Italy and my own country, Sweden. God knows what happens next election in France with Le Pen. And just because we're here at CEU, I also just pull up two maps of democracy and academic freedom index. And you can see the distinct overlap, just giving more data to what we just heard. Academic freedom is intrinsically, of course, connected to democracy, and academic freedom is one of the things they like to attack first and the most. Everything we do is public. It's available on the website. Always have to show that, including the data and these online graphs and things, and the democracy report, of course. On that note, let me say thank you, and I look forward to the panel discussion and the questions.
Thank you very much, Stefan, also for the excellent timekeeping. I think the trends that you have highlighted about polarization are also an excellent way into exploring this further with Marlene, whose work is to a large extent on tribalism and identity politics. And we definitely do see this trend rising across the European Union, and we will probably see that also beyond. So with that, I would pass the floor on to you, and I would suggest that we will collect questions and move to the discussion after we have heard all of your contributions.
Thank you, Susanna. And since I don't need so much exercise as that, I will not stand up, but sit here comfortably where I am. Thank you so much for inviting me. And it's great to be here, to be back at the CAU. I really enjoy it. I would like to pick up, yes, I'm going to say a few words about my book that you, many of you know, The Tribalization of Europe. But I would actually like to start in a different corner, because Stefan talked about the third wave, and I will talk to you, or start with talking to you about another third wave of autocratization that you are not talking about, but that most lawyers are talking about. And what is that? Well, it actually comes out of a journal article written by Joseph Weiler from the NYU. Who, and since I have this more legal perspective than most in this room, at least that's what I could understand today, then I think this is really, really important, because it also helps us grasp what's really going on here. What Joe Weiler and one of his younger scholars talk about in this article is that after the Second World War, you had constitutional democracy spreading with the point of departure in Europe. Most countries turned into constitutional democracies that we also discussed earlier today, leaving majoritarian democracy. Going into constitutional democracy with strong courts in Europe, the third wave, the second wave, as he describes it, is the acceptance among these countries, but also outside Europe, of supranational law into their own law, accepting that when you have a convention, when you have a European court, you will accept the legislation, the cases, the decisions coming out of that level. The third wave that he describes is the wave we are seeing right now, where an increasing number of countries that used to adopt this approach, they all of a sudden have turned around and have started to do judicial review of those international rules. So the rules and the institutions that they used to accept after the Second World War, all of a sudden are becoming questioned. All of a sudden, We see it in Hungary, we see it in Poland in particular, where questioning supranational law. That is the third wave in this perspective. So the question is, of course, whether this is not only a European trend. What Joe Weiler says is that it's a global trend. You see it in many countries that start questioning also international law and elevating sovereignty, self-determination, the idea of no one should rule over us. This whole rhetoric has come back. Where I do not agree with Joe Weiler, and I was actually quite shocked when I read this article, was that he actually understands it. He says in this article that, this is understandable, too much international law, too many courts that are too strong, and now people are turning against it. I haven't confronted him with this perspective, but I wrote a counter argument in a French journal last year, where I say, take care of the identitarian counterwave, because he says it's an identitarian counterwave that he understands. And maybe this is where things are moving right now, and I warn against it. I think it's incredibly dangerous to tear down everything we build up after the Second World War. But what is it then that we need to understand better, also as scientists? I think, first of all, as scientists who try to understand what's going on, we need to, first of all, understand the difference between constitutional democracy and majoritarian democracy. This is a distinction that Ronald Dworkin, the American legal theorist, has made many years ago, and it was not in any way applied to the EU. But I think that we are actually seeing a slow breakdown on constitutional democracy in Europe. In my own part of the world and the UK, we never had constitutional democracy. And what do I mean? I mean, we didn't have strong courts at all. We never had that. In my own country, which is a majoritarian, I would say increasingly semi authoritarian, in the sense that if you have a majority, you're right. You have sovereignty in parliament. Only once in 170 years did a court strike down what the majority did. I know Sweden as well have very weak courts, no tradition for judicial review. And I think we need to be very careful when we talk about democracy. What type of democracy are we talking about? Political scientists have, in my opinion, been too quick to say, is there an election? You know, that's Robert Dahl, Sean Peter, all those people who have taught, we have used talk telling students about democracy. Is there an election? It's a democracy. Is there no election? It's not a democracy. But it also depends on what democracy looks like. And that is, in my opinion, very, very important. Another distinction that is very important, in my opinion, and it's also building on research that is coming out in Democratization next year, an article I published with a colleague, is that we need to distinguish between the autocratization happening in Europe, where we have the most legalized network building blocks in the world, where you have to sign up to fundamental values to become a member, and then countries outside Europe where it's very much different. I think you can criticize countries that should live up to this to a much larger degree than countries outside. I also think that the techniques are different. In the classical destruction of democracy, it was coups, it was jailing people you didn't like, it was about closing of media in a different way than you see in Hungary, where it's done much more elegantly, quotation mark, where you simply just put in a new editorial board. You pretend it's still running, it's the same newspaper, but in reality you have autocratized the media landscapes entirely. So it's much more subtle, and that's where I think we have some problems with the kind of measurement tools that we are working with. But before that, I think there's also another, before I come to that, I have a slide with me, just one, showing that. I just want to make one point about the other aspect of the new type of autocratization, and that is using post-factual arguments, denying the truth, tribalizing, at least that's how I talk about it in my book. In my analysis, it's a very advanced technique where you use deliberately use narratives. Very often you have spin doctors educated in the highest and best universities who help you, who help the political leader, even in democracies in Europe, to draw up a narrative that separates you from your enemies. And I see that in many other places than just Eastern Europe. You have political leaders who are not facing up to critical journalism, who are posting all their messages on social media instead of doing that, and increasingly using identity politics to sort of create a base of support in the population. So my argument is that it's no longer just economy stupid, it has become identity stupid. I see that also in the Nordic countries. Sweden, you talk about that a lot because of what happened recently, but in my country, it's the Social Democrats who have copycatted the extreme right and now follow this narrative, refusing to talk to journalists, appear only on Facebook, communicating only with your friends, etc., etc. It's a general phenomenon we are seeing, and therefore we should be incredibly careful. So what is it, just to finalize, what is it we see and why is it so different from the old classical autocratization? As I said before, the classical autocratization was much more visible. It was much easier to measure. You cannot measure easily a destruction of democracy that happens within democratic institutions. And a very good example of that in my from my own research is, and I hope it's there, it doesn't work. I want to go to my, yes, here it is. Yeah, you can look at three, you can see you're the best. The vegan is definitely the best, but you see three different measuring institutions that measure the same countries in the same period. So we have a problem when some of the most relied on measurement instruments, measurement institutions, they simply do not capture the destruction of democracy within within democratic institutions. And that is one of the big challenges, as I see it, when looking at the EU, where we have consolidated democracies, it's much more difficult to capture what is actually going on with democracy in our part of the world. One of the reasons is that countries use, as Kim Lane Shepler from Princeton has called, autocratic legalism. What is that? It means that you use the law to destroy the law. So the law is used in a way that is very hard to detect because there's a majority behind it. You have amended the constitution with a majority and you have changed the electoral rules with a majority. How do you capture that? It's very, very difficult. And the same goes for the courts, of course. Yes, you do talk about judicial review. You do talk about courts that come up with decisions. But these courts are no longer democratic. They are captured. And that is very, very difficult to measure. And therefore, I would also advise the project that I'm advising here to be incredibly careful. First of all, not to only distinguish democracies on the basis of elections. Courts are incredibly important, and in particular, real independent courts, and not just captured courts. And then, of course, to be aware of how democracy very often can be destroyed from within, and in particular, when looking at Europe and the European Union, I think we need much more sensitivity to this than we have given so far. And I look very much forward to following your project, but also to work with some of the other people in this room on this topic. Thank you very much.
Indeed, I think your cautionary advice to look broad and take various dimensions into account is very much taken to heart by the project. And that is precisely one of our goals, to really understand various challenges, various dimensions of challenges, which very much echoes what Professor Ignatia was saying, that the neo-authoritarian challenges, threats that we see today are appearing in legal terms, in ideological terms, in institutional terms, and so on and so forth. So thank you very much again to reiterate that. And that would also lead us a bit further into some of these areas of contestation. It's not only institutions, it's not only the legal system, but we do see identity politics as an area of contestation where really polarization is pursued, where it's where the area of identity politics is essentially instrumentalized to further political goals of the very often incumbents by now, of challengers of democracy. So with that, I would pass the floor on to Mika, whose research area very much connects to this segment of the dimensions we want to explore.
Yeah. So it's a great discussion already with the colleagues, and I would like to engage with them, but we will not do that now. And I want to shift the attention a little bit and zoom out a bit. Even if I'm political science by position, I like the zooming out always very much. So this project, Israel varieties of liberalism and neo-authoritarianism, very ambitious, important, great consortium. I'm very happy to be here and to be able to discuss with you. So my own interest and my own research, partly also together with Andrea Crisan, who's here also at CU, in a new project called Kindle on anti-gender campaigns in Europe and how it's connected to the troubles with democracy. Is on this, how changes in gender regime, and gender regime is a term that Sylvia Wolby uses, and if you think that patriarchy is one form of gender regime, then you can see what she means, like there's different forms of it, and current challenges to democracy across Europe and beyond Europe, but I don't know about that, it's beyond my expertise, how are these interrelated? So there's much to study and to understand there. And what do I think are good starting points to understand this? And I will present two starting points here that are both rooted in my own understanding of current dynamics of increasing illiberalism and neo-authoritarianism. And for this, I have to zoom out, because while this illiberalism and this neo-authoritarianism is a process of change in the domain of the polity, it would be wrong, or it would not be helpful, I think, to understand it within that domain only. What do I mean with that? I will sometimes, you know, have my reading glasses too far away from myself, and then I have to see where I was. What I mean is that we are currently witnessing is not about changes in the polity only. We are witnessing a project, a political project, to change society as a whole. And these changes in the polity are part of that. And we need to keep that in mind. So this project is a project of autocratization of not just the polity. It has a vision for the whole of society within that. And if you see this as a project and you see that it also has a vision about the whole of society, then it will make it easier to understand also why gender is so suddenly important in politics all of a sudden. Because the project is acknowledging that. I'm very grateful for that. As gender studies scholars, we tell them for a long time that it is important, but now it has also reached a much higher point on the political agenda. So I have two messages or question marks around this here. And the first is that the visions of autocratic societies that are embedded in these illiberal neo-authoritarian ideologies and practices that have already been shown to include a strong focus on gender and sexuality issues. And the second is that all current analyses and experiences point to a worrying speeding up of these autocratic attempts, a worrying speeding up of the pace of change that you also can understand, I think, better with the concepts we use in trying to understand the fate of gender in this project of societal change. And for this, these two elements, I will elaborate a little bit on it. So first, this vision of that illiberalism and neo-authoritarianism have on gender, what is it? What does it mean? So going back to my basic understanding that they want to change society, I rephrase this question as, what are the societal domains in this vision that are so central in the autocratic project and that imply a focus on gender and sexuality? And I have to create a societal domain that is not out there in theory yet, unless in some of my writings, a little bit in the footnotes and whatever. And most of you have not seen as a domain before, but that you should. So we're used to see societal domains like the polity and the economy, and we've already heard that economy is important and we should look at it. I based myself on Sylvia Wolby's social complexity theory, more specifically her book on globalization and inequalities and a stream of publications later. And I'm adding two domains to her set of societal domains. She says there's the polity, there's economy, there's violence, including police, and there's civil society, which is anything else. I add two domains. We talked this morning already about the importance of seeing episteme as a domain including all the different institutions in a society that construct truth and the truth about reality. So that ranges from religion to science, to media, and we've seen important changes in that. And I would add another domain that I call catexis, which is a domain that organizes how a society deals with bodies, with sexualities, with physical reproduction and fertility. There's lots of medical institutions there, there's specific institutions that work with that. If we see this as a domain, then we can more easily detect and articulate the autocratic vision about catexis that put gender at the heart of this project and about their contestations and illiberal practices. This vision is ultimately about controlling fertility of its citizens, fertility of particular kind of citizens. Now, in one of the previous projects with Andrea, we could see that already. Now, if you think at forced sterilization in Sweden until the 70s of Roma, if you think of different social welfare measures for foreigners in France or for Roma families with more than three kids that shouldn't be reproducing so much, you see that he's always already been present. It's also about their sexual autonomy as important driver of personal autonomy and empowerment. And this is a factor that we've rarely looked at. And to me, it's no surprise that it is important. is a domain that has a strong way of constructing empowerment and autonomy of citizens, and therefore enabling democracy or constraining it. So my second point about the speeding up of the pace is, I turn again to Sylvia Wolby and other people that work with social complexity theory, which is that we should not see changes as a linear process of cause and effect. In social complexity theory, and you know that probably, that in biology is how they understand ecosystems, every effect is a cause. Again, it goes back. It's always circular. You have a cause, and this effect is causing further change. So if this cause is changing in the same direction, then you get a positive feedback loop. No? If you have, I mean, to give a positive example, it's negative enough. If you have more women in politics, it will have the effect. There's more role models for women in politics. That will have a positive influence on the number of candidates of women in politics, which might increase and speed up the change. So this type of concept is what we thoroughly need to understand the pace of change here. And in this, social complexity theory in Wolby's form sees all these different domains, the polity, the economy, violence, but also catexis and episteme, if we understand them like that, as systems, which means they are constructed so that they reproduce themselves. That's imperfect, necessarily. And the other domains are their environment. And they co-evolve with changes in the environment. So if we have a total restriction of sexual autonomy and sexual empowerment, and a total control of fertility, this will also impact negatively back on polity, on economy probably also. So I think this type of concept is also what could link our understanding to such like more separate concepts, like the one that was used in the morning by Manuela Cayani of critical junctures, tipping points in international relations. There's some of these concepts that are used, but we should try and use them more broadly into our modeling of how do we think that these changes evolve. And in doing so, we might be on a path of understanding better what's happening. Thank you.
Thank you very much for bringing in these new aspects for our consideration. And one key issue that you mentioned here, the importance of episteme and the institutions of the institutions of truth construction, food production, are particularly interesting when we are thinking about neo-authoritarianisms. Yeah. And looking at the country where we are and the post-truth context that we are facing, just to bring in the very present example of the newest national consultation of the Hungarian government, I think we can understand why this is a particularly important new domain of neo-authoritarianism in this context.
I think to see it as a domain enables to theorize the shift from science to media in constructing this logic. And if you only look at those different institutions, it's more difficult to see the shifts between them. Anyway.
Absolutely, and I think there's really a lot to it, just like to everything that you have said, and we will circle back to all of this in the discussion. But I wanted to particularly pick up on this idea, because I think this really resonates both in the European and also in the American context. So this definitely does bind the two, if we can talk about two cases, together. But there are also important differences between how we see autocratization in Europe and the challenges that liberal democracy faces in the United States. I wanted to bring in Thomas on this point to shed some light on those potential differences, similarities that we see across the pond on the field.
Good. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. It's always wonderful to speak at CEU for all that it is and all that it stands for. Great to be with this excellent panel and also with many longtime friends. I'd like to talk a little bit about some of what I think are some important differences between illiberal right-wing politics in the United States and in Europe. By Europe here, I'll actually today just be referring to Northern, Western, and Southern Europe. I won't be bringing in comparisons to Central or Eastern Europe. I don't want to overload the comparative framework. There's only a little bit of time. These are actually just exploratory thoughts, notes to myself in a way that I wanted to share with you that sometimes helps me to think out loud, to inflict it on an audience when I start thinking about a topic. So you'll forgive me if these are rather provisional and also if I move rather fast through rather large territory and make some probably strained generalizations for the sake of simplicity. Viewed from some distance, right-wing politics in the United States and in Europe bears some important similarities. If you look at the basic ideological outlook of what is now the mainstream right in the United States, it's not the far right, it's the mainstream right in the United States with what is still considered the far right in Europe, there's obvious ideological similarities. There's the powerful dislike of immigration, the desire to restrict immigration. On the social domain, there's the powerful attempt to change gender politics in a very different direction, and also in sexuality with LGBTQ rights and other associated issues. On the economic side, there's a kind of a penchant for economic protectionism and a sort of rejection of globalization, however that's interpreted. And then on the geopolitical front, of course, there's a softness for Russia, and a sort of a preference for a new kind of multipolarity that diminishes the importance of the West. So you could say, well, it just all sounds very similar. But in the United States, the United States is facing what I believe is actually a near-term fundamental democratic crisis of the system, which has the following characteristics right now. It's a presidential system, and in the last presidential election, the incumbent president has rejected the results of the election and refuses to respect them. 70% of people who vote for that party, 70% of registered Republicans, refuse to accept the legitimacy of that election. You have a growing systematic attack on the core electoral institutions, an attempt to gain control of those institutions at the state level in order to change voter access and potentially change the integrity of the system. You have increasing association with armed militia groups, who are now pervasive throughout many parts of the society. And you have the degradation of legitimacy for core institutions of law enforcement, like the FBI, like the courts when they go against you, and other institutions like prosecutors. This is a systemic crisis. This is getting at the core engine of democracy, which is the ability to choose it. And there are very near-term plausible scenarios that the next presidential election will be a failed election in some sense, that it will not bring the country through a transfer of power in some legitimate and widely accepted way. That is a systemic crisis right now in the face of the country. In Europe, by contrast, you have fundamental clash of values going on, and that's starting to hurt institutions in different ways. But I would argue, and I know this always upsets my European friends when I say they're not as bad off as people like to feel they are, it's not as bad yet as what's happening in the United States. Now you could say, but when and how? We'll get to that. I need to move quickly here. So why? Given the similarities of right-wing politics on the two sides of the Atlantic, why is the United States in the midst of systemic crisis? In Europe, as Michael said in his talk, right-wing populism has been working its way from outside the system to try to enter the system and to occupy main positions in the system. And it's making some progress in some countries. In the United States, right-wing politics in a two-party system, a presidential two-party system, right-wing politics have been at the core of American politics for a very, very long time. They're not working their way into the system. They're there. They're in the core of it. And people have been a bit distracted by the fact that the Republican Party in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s went through a sort of a period in which more center-right elements were predominant in the party, and only in the 80s, 90s, and more recently have the more right-wing elements once again taken hold of that party. But the 50s, 60s, and 70s were something more, as I'll say, of an interruption of a larger pattern. The larger pattern is fundamental polarization since the founding of the Republic of the society around conflicting visions of what America is along three axes. And this is very different from European politics. The first is there's a fundamental debate that has gone on in the American Republic since its founding over whether the United States should have a strong central state or not, between federalism versus states' rights. This is a fundamental debate. You still today have a conservative party that doesn't really want to see taxes collected because it doesn't really believe in the central state. It has tried to degrade the tax service, for example, because it believes the collection of taxes is in itself a bad thing. That is not something that's debated in European politics, in my impression. Europeans have accepted the idea of a central state as something that's just sort of normal in politics. That is an issue of fundamental debate. Second, race and inclusion. The United States, through its entire history, has had its politics dominated by racial divide in the country. We had a civil war, a long, bloody, terrible civil war, all the way through to today. If you want to find the most divisive question, sociologists will tell you to ask an American today, an American voter, is what do you think of the Black Lives Matter movement? If you want to divide the room into two parts, all you have to do is ask that question. You have a politics of race, which is a fundamental division. And a third fundamental division, which is again different from Europe, is religion and the role of religion in politics. The United States is a fundamentally more religious society than any European country, with maybe two exceptions, Ireland and Poland. The United States is a fundamentally religious country, and a lot of the religion is evangelical, and a lot of the religion is about inserting religion into politics in a way that, again, that issue in Europe has been settled, thought it was settled for a long time. So US polarization is the mobilization of these three axes on either side. Some people believe in a strong central state, racial inclusion, and a low role for religion. Some people have the opposite view, a weak central state, a racial exclusion, and a high role for religion. That is a fundamental divide. And that's why when Stefan puts up that chart of polarization, it's not there now. The United States is way up there. Spain, I was just looking quickly, is the next European country. It's far down on the chart. There's no European country anywhere close to the kind of polarization that is seen in the US. Because of polarization, this is rooted around three axes that have been settled in European politics for a long time. Now, they may be coming into question, particularly the issue of inclusion, because in the last 10 to 20 years, immigration issues entered the European mindset, political life, in ways that bring to the fore the issue of inclusivity, but in general has not been an issue like in the United States. So you have a level of polarization, which is fundamental. Two sides, the politics of enemies, which is hardened now in the United States, where 70% roughly of Republicans feel that the Democratic Party is a fundamental threat to America. Somewhere, I think, about 60% of Democrats in the Republican Party say fundamental. When each side sees the other, as Michael said, it is an important article in the Journal of Democracy, as a fundamental political enemy. You have a problem on that. You have a serious problem on that. Now, up until now, the system has, once it collapsed during the Civil War and then kind of came back together, hesitantly for a long time, but came back together, the system has held this divide together, but now it seems to be straining and risking to break. Why? Why now? Why in the last 5, 10, 20 years has it started to break? Because one of the two sides is having trouble winning elections. In the last 34 years, the Republicans have won the popular vote in the presidential election one time. 2004, first election after 9/11, when Americans kind of rallied around George Bush. In other words, for the last third of a century, They've lost every single election except for one exception. The handwriting is on the wall. They're not going to win through elections. So what do? Destroy elections. Gerrymander to the extreme. Undercut electoral access for citizens, make it hard to vote, undercut the integrity of state institutions, and deny the legitimacy of elections you lose. So you have a problem on your hand when you have a two-part situation, a fundamental polarization, and one side begins to believe that alternation of power is no longer going to naturally happen, and so it has to go after the system. This is what's happening in the United States. This, I would argue, is why right-wing politics in the United States have taken on the nature of a fundamental battle that is only brewing in places, in parts of Europe, whether it's Sweden, or Italy, or Denmark, or others that feel tremors and feel the hollowing out of institutions through this kind of fundamentalism, unwillingness to talk to the other side, and so forth. So my argument is, my time is up, that there really are important similarities between the ideas of right-wing liberalism on the two sides of the Atlantic, but the two sides were in a very, very different place as a result of our different histories. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. We have about 20 minutes left at our hand, and I would not like to abuse my position as the chair. I think we have really great minds in this room. So rather, I would open up the floor for your questions and comments. And when you take the floor, please introduce yourself. We would like to jump in. We have a hand there.
Hello, so I'm Gennady Yakov, postdoctoral fellow at the Institute for Advanced Studies at TU. To Professor Wim, you have told that the existing doubt-based indexes of democracy are bad at capturing the early stages of democratic excellence. And you mentioned judiciary. Do you know any existing indicators of the strength of judiciary? Or maybe there are any other indicators that you would use in the research to grasp these early stages of backslides?
I would suggest that maybe if there are other questions, that we collect a few. Peter?
Thank you. I'm Peter Molnar, and I'm a free speech scholar. And following up on what Michael said on the importance of putting hopeful helmet, which sort of narrows down our view only for what we think, I would like to ask, what do you think, how can we deal with dangers of liberal righteousness? And what I mean by that, of course, is not that we should question whether concentration of power is a bad thing, but it seems that often what happens that in liberal progressive discourse, what happens is what is called liberal righteousness, that we sort of tend to assume of them that we are the people who really think, and we are the people who can conceptualize law, and I think that's a problem. So we think we should see that others who disagree with us have their own freedom of thought, and they can think things otherwise, except, again, concentration of power, not in the sense of what Thomas mentioned, that state power as opposed to federal power, but so what do you think of this?
Thank you very much. Are there any other immediate burning questions?
Question to Mika. You said that the new authoritarians are trying to change the society. I think you are absolutely right. But we also want to change the society. And maybe some of the powers of this recent neoliberal appeal come exactly from the fact that it's the liberals who are seen as the one who has started to politicize this area, and they are seen as the ones who want to depart radically from the status quo or status quo ante. So I wonder to what extent can we consider neo-authoritarians as a kind of defensive movement structured around this fundamental, almost pre-political instinct of preserving certain relations that we grew up in.
Thank you very much. Professor.
Thank you to everybody for a fascinating panel. I had a question about the gender domain. It's really a question to both of you, which is, I had always, Tom, you were implying that on gender questions, the American right is essentially aligned with the European in terms of hostility, for example, with LGBT. And I'm wondering whether that's right and whether there's in fact a bit of a difference there, that even the Republican right has accepted gay marriage, for example, doesn't want to roll that back, and has less of, and is less on. So then my question is, why in Europe is the gender issue so absolutely central for Orban, for many other? Is there any difference between how the Americans and the Europeans think about that? And then I had a question about neo-autocratization. I'd said there were four countries, and you said six, and one of the two had to do with, I guess, the Czech Republic and something. So my question is a technical question, but what measures of autocratization you're using, particularly in relation to Slovenia, Croatia, places like that, that give you your autocratization scores in those areas?
Thank you very much. I think we have quite a few questions already. Let's continue with some answers, and I think we will have time for one more round. So I'll get back to you. Who would like to start?
A lot of
them are teams. No, I don't mind. It's fine. It's okay. It's okay to start. So, we also want to change society, right? I mean, it's true that in 2013, I tried to get an ESC advance grant to look at opposition to gender equality in Europe, arguing that there is a progress bias, where nobody thinks that this can ever be rolled back. And this is like how things should be. And which was not what I was seeing if I was looking at politics through the lens also of the Green Project that looked at all the countries in the European Union. So yes, I think there is a degree of complacency. And yes, of course, in politics, everyone is always believing that they are right, okay? So the point is that everyone should resist what Lefort calls this totalitarian temptation of democracy, the wish to go sit in that seat of power forever, because you know what should happen with society. No? If you're democratic, you know that this is a totalitarian temptation that you should resist, right? So, but it's true that there has been in Europe a kind of a complacency that we all agree on that, we move in that direction, and so on. So I don't think, though, that I don't think it's useful to assume an honest desire to preserve the status quo. I think it's more useful in the current like autocratization to assume evilness. I think this is much more useful, because it's going to make you see this faster, because this progress bias, we all have it still in us. We can't believe what's happening. So let's put glasses on that tell us this is evil supply side. This is not necessarily only honest responses to the demand side, because maybe it is to a certain degree. And I think to blame voters, never gonna work anyway, but also they might have their honest reasons for voting like that. But the problem is not with them. The problem is with the supply side and rigging elections and rigging the construction of reality and producing lies. So it's better to assume people. I think this is my answer to you. Is I don't know if it's academic. It's just what I think is true. And then on gender, is there a difference between the US and Europe? I think if you look at gender and sexuality and you look at issues like same-sex marriage, you might not see that. If you look at abortion, you see the similarity immediately because there's no autocratic regime in the world that doesn't like think this is a very nice measure to take. So to restrain and to control fertility in many ways, including restricting or not restricting physical reproduction, all you know, limited to whether you're the wrong ethnic origin or anything like that. So there is, and if you look on not at same-sex marriage, but at, on adoption and on reproductive rights for lesbians, no? I mean, all these autocratic regimes, I want more citizens. You know, let them give reproductive right to lesbians. They will have more citizens. Nah, that's not the kind of citizens they want. No? So they construct a normal citizen first. And then they control fertility and sexuality accordingly. And in this, I think that the fundamental similarities are probably a bit bigger than the fundamental differences between those. Yeah.
Shall we continue connected to this?
But I don't know.
Yeah, let me just, if I just pick up on that in your question, Michael. It's a hard one, but I would be hesitant to say that there's been a kind of a threshold crossed on LGBTQ rights in the United States, and that sort of the United States has kind of passed a certain place and it's not going to go back. First, the transgender issue has become a very mobilizing issue among Republicans, which is related to the sexuality issue, and it leads over very easily into the LGBTQ issue. And it's become, just as it has in some other countries like this one, a constant source of discussion around the circles and animation and mobilization. And, you know, in the recent decision, which overruled Roe v. Wade, if you read into the decision, you know, Clarence Thomas is joining the opinion that it was clear. He said, you know, one could also imagine further steps. What he meant was the rolling back of same-sex marriage. So in the hard right, there's the dream of victory after victory, like a cascade of victories here, and we'll unroll this carpet and bring it back up. And so I wouldn't be so confident.
Yeah, plus I think the transgender issue works very well because it is also a division within the feminist movement. Mm-hmm. So what better issue can you have, right, than one that potentially can divide your opponent?
Thank you. Which of you would like to?
I can go. I just wanted to add to that with the supply side, that's exactly my point as well, that we are seeing this in all democratic countries, that it's a new way of winning elections. It's to supply the narratives. It's supply the lies, to construct reality in a way that gives you the votes. And I think we see that even in countries that are more positive towards LGBT rights, we see another kind of demonization of wokeness. In my country, it's all about vote. If you're too woke, you're terrible, you know. So cutting down on money to those who study gender and you know, immigration and all these kind of things, they should be monitored by politicians, interestingly. Just to come back to your question about how to detect backsliding or autocratization at an early level, one way could be to look at what is judicial independence. You know, there's a big debate about it because what they say in Poland, the government right now, is, well, you also don't have judicial independence in Germany. You don't have judicial independence in Denmark. I mean, we have a minister of justice who appoints the judges. Is that independence? So I think you need to pin down to a much more particular degree what is actually meant by the words we are using to describe liberal democracy. And we need also to realize that maybe we need a harmonization in Europe on what it takes to be called independent and to have an independent judiciary. Maybe we also have to think about the way we are doing things, because it's very easy to just pinpoint, well, you have a law like that, so we have no problem, right? Exactly as you said about the university here, that they were just pointing at Bavaria saying, well, you also have, you know, in Germany, a rule about the government appointing which universities should be able to operate and so on. So we need a much bigger sensitivity. And that's the problem with a lot of the measurements that we are using, that they do not have the sensitivity. And to some degree, I think we as political scientists have been simply just not clear enough on what we mean by democracy. We have in a lot of literature and years and years and years been distinguishing democracy from rule of law, right? Well, it's our own problem. Now we are sitting there and people are talking about democracy. Oh, it's only about elections. So what about rule of law? Well, is that part of democracy? I mean, that whole debate is, I think, very, very important in order to pinpoint what is actually counted when you do the counting of who is a democracy and not. And in my opinion, when you live in a liberal European Union, liberal democratic European Union, you cannot just be, you know, having elections without the rule of law. And we have signed up to that, and therefore, I think that we can demand that of all countries. And that was a question, an answer to you, who said about why are we to say what is right and what is wrong? Well, I mean, you can leave the European Union if you want. Nobody forces you to be here. The UK left. So if you sign up to a club that is where democracy is, not just voting, but also the rule of law, I think we have a very
and
clear
fundamental
picture.
Right.
And that's what I mean with rule of law and fundamental rights. Then we have a completely different story here, and I think we should insist on that.
Thank you very much. Since we were talking a little bit about measurements, I think that's a good way for you to address Professor Inadev's question about how you measure.
Yeah, I see time is running out as well. VDEM has about 20 measures of judicial independence and other things that have to do with the judiciary. Our measures of autocratization here, based on liberal democracy index, it's 48 indicators, including judicial independence. I think for several of the cases here that I showed, those were driving, I mean, part of driving it, but of course, other things too. And when we call something that we say that a country is an episode of autocratization, what we mean is that the difference has become statistically significant outside of confidence intervals, because we provide estimates of uncertainty. We don't pretend that anything can be measured without error. But I think I wanted to comment briefly, although there are only 2 minutes left now, but I think the broader picture from my perspective, right? I mean, there are differences, and I think Tom pointed to them very clearly with the United States. I think we can find other differences if we look at the Philippines or we look at Turkey beginning in 2005-06 and so on. The global picture for me is that autocratization is driven almost everywhere by right-wing nationalist reactionary parties and leaders. And then comes the gender part with it. I mean, no doubt. and they aligned themselves, and Putin started this, with whatever religion in an orthodox, backward-looking or radical version. He started with the Orthodox Church, Erdogan, Muslim reactionary nationalist, Modi in India with a Hindu nationalist reactionary, Trump with the evangelicals, and Bolsonaro. We can go down the line. Orban became suddenly a Christian, right? And it's almost like Putin wrote sort of a playbook for this in the early 2000s. And in this context that we are now, and then you add to it with China and their efforts, Saudi Arabia since the late 1980s with their efforts, spreading Salafism, and so on. In this context, now you're looking at your phone, but I think for within academic inquiry, yes, we must confront the issues that you also brought up and sort of the weaknesses of liberal democracy. In the world today, I think that in the past 20 years, the problem has not been that liberal democracies and advocates of liberal democracy have been not questioning liberal democracy enough or have not been open to alternatives. I think we're being too open and too compromised willing and too sort of, oh yeah, there are other ways of, right? Democratic rights are human rights as well, according to the UN Charter, right? And I think the Putin's invasion of Ukraine finally made leaders in democracies that remain in the world and the EU to sit up and realize that we may have to defend democracy again with arms in our hands. They have to do it right now. I think on the world scene, it's not the time to be apologetic about liberal democracy. It's about defending democracy.
Indeed, time is running low and out, but we were very graciously allowed a few extra minutes by our hosts. And I promised a question to Stefan, so I would also...
Really, after that conclusion, I fully agree with it. I think that was a terrific way to say it. It's a point at which we need to stand up and defend liberal democracy and not be so defensive about it. I think that's the way I would like to end, rather than my stupid question.
All right, then I think this is where we will end the discussion, at least in this room. We will definitely can continue outside, and we will continue in the coming 3 years. We have received some really great and inspiring thoughts, which apparently is also shown by the raise of hands that we have received after your answers. So thank you very much to you all for joining us today, for providing your knowledge and helping us kicking off this project. And thank you very much to everybody who has joined us here at CEU and also online. Please, if you haven't done so already, follow us on Twitter, on Facebook, also on YouTube. So those who have missed the talk here will be able to watch the video later on online. Thank you very much.